Access to Water and Energy Consortium program. And this is a program that we started this past year, and we have a number of members now. And although most people would think that access to water and energy was restricted mostly in developing countries, but it's also a critical issue in the US. And Ning Lin at the Bureau and Michael Young and Scott Tinker and I have been advancing this program. And Maria-Elena Giner is our first speaker. And I'll give you a little bit of background about Maria-Elena. She works at the intersection between public policy and infrastructure and focusing particularly on measuring results. She enrolled in the PhD program in 2017 at the LBJ School under the supervision of Professor David Eaton. And prior to her PhD program, Maria-Elena was appointed by the US and Mexican governments in 2010 as the general manager for the BEC, Border Environment Cooperation Commission. And much of her work under BEC focused on modernizing the institution by expanding programs and updating organizational tools related to the dynamic needs of the US-Mexico border region residents, focusing primarily on municipal infrastructure and balancing the interests of the two governments. Prior to her appointment, Maria-Elena served in various senior positions at municipal utility industry and in private consulting in the counties along the US-Mexico border. And she is a registered professional engineer in the state of Texas. And she's going to talk today about implementing water and wastewater infrastructure in underserved communities in Texas along the US-Mexico border. What did we learn? So Maria-Elena, thanks for doing this with us today, and we're looking forward to your presentation.
Okay, so I'm gonna do the share screen. Okay.
Sorry, I forgot to mention one thing, Maria-Elena. We have two IT professionals today who are helping us, and this is Aaron Everett and Carlos Garza. And Aaron will collate the questions on YouTube, and we will be able to ask the questions that will be addressed in the chat in Zoom. So if you have any questions, please include them in the chat, and Aaron will discuss the questions from Zoom or from YouTube. Thanks. Go ahead, Maria-Elena.
So I want to start a little bit about my background. I know Bridget introduced me, but really my journey to getting to do a PhD at LBJ at the tender age of 48. That was, you know, going back to school after working being a practitioner for so many years, I get that question a lot. So I'm a civil engineer, and most of the time I've always worked on your typical infrastructure projects related to water, wastewater, land. But I joined an organization that in 1997 called the Border Environment Cooperation Commission. And I really grew there in that organization because I started as their project manager and progressed over the 20 years I was there to ultimately being the general manager as the appointed by both the US and the Mexican government. For those of you who are unfamiliar with this organization, it's really a unique organization because it was formed out of NAFTA, and they have offices in Ciudad Juarez and in San Antonio, and their mission is to oversee environmental infrastructure, help communities in developing infrastructure, developing and building. And it's really for the purpose of preventing, controlling, or reducing environmental pollutants, you know, to improve the higher quality of life. What's really unique about this organization is that they have 10 board members, and half of them are from the US and half of them are from Mexico. And of the 10, six of them are federal agencies. We have EPAs on the board, as well as their Mexican counterpart, Semarnat. Department of State is on the board, as well as their counterpart, Relaciones Exteriores. And then of course, Treasury is on the board of directors, as well as their Mexican counterpart. So these agents, this organization, they provided grants and loans to almost every community along the border. And a lot of their core work was in water and wastewater. And here are the social and environmental benefits. This is one of the things that I really started at the organization, was starting to not just talk about money going out the door, but actually what was coming from it. And so most of the projects that we worked on were in water and wastewater, and really in wastewater. And we always like to highlight that these projects in water and wastewater benefited almost 13 million border residents. Then the whole border region is about 15 million. And specifically on wastewater, enough capacity was built to eliminate 462 million gallons per day of raw sewage that was previously untreated. The other statistic that we like to highlight is related to the 27 energy projects that were all renewable energies, I believe, except for one, that really were really important towards offsetting some of these GHG emissions. And then for, of course, I am an engineer, so I have to talk about the bricks and mortar that was built. And so the big item here, as you can see, we've done drinking water, but is the 62 wastewater treatment plants and the 99 wastewater collection systems, as well as the almost 1,600 megawatts of renewable energy that was built. And we participated in just about every single renewable energy project along the border. Now, this is one of the statistics that we were really proud of as an organization. Like I said, I started in 1997, and a lot of the funding didn't start flowing until about 1998. And so this is for Mexican communities along the border, which is about 8 to 9 million residents. And in 1995, before our organization really got started, only 21% of the population had wastewater treatment. Because of the work that we did in working with Mexican communities, we actually increased that to 87%, and now by 2012, and that has actually, you know, almost reached the 95% as of today. The rest of Mexico has an average of 46% at that time. So really, these agencies were really working very hard with funds from EPA and CONAGUA and the Mexican border states on really addressing wastewater flows that were flowing into the binational watersheds that were untreated. So this led to my journey of studying public policy. All of this money was being approved, and we were only beginning to scratch the surface of measuring results. So here's some of the money that's been approved. So as of the March 2017, there were 115 projects in the US with, you know, $3.36 billion worth of construction funds that were going out. And in Mexico was $5.4 billion, 138 projects. But in the US, of that, all of the funds that were going out, about half of them were for Texas projects. So even though I'm an engineer, I felt that many decisions were being made at the public policy net level that were important to create sustainable projects or sustainable infrastructure. And so for me, that's the reason why I'm here today. And I wanted to apply this experience that I had while I was at the BEC of implementing a progressive agenda on just not only results measurement. I implemented an energy efficiency and water utilities program and got some really, really tangible results, which, you know, I'm pending writing up on. And then finally, the other one, which I did publish a paper on, was on the use of green infrastructure for stormwater management along the US-Mexico border. So right now, I'm actually wanting to apply this experience to the Texas colonias. We worked a lot with the Texas colonias, and my research looks at the various programs that provided first-time water and wastewater service. Specifically, what did we learn from these programs, and did we make an impact? So for those of you that are unfamiliar of what a colonia is just a residential subdivision that's typically unincorporated. There are some that are incorporated, but they lack some of the basic services such as water and sewer, paved roads and electricity. And at the time when I started this research, there was documentation that 75% of the population had water. They lacked, but what they really lacked was wastewater collection. Almost no one had wastewater collection. So what is the issue with not having wastewater? Because we've all used outhouses and ranches or isolated state parks, But what happens when you use, you know, a cesspool or an outhouse in a neighborhood that's actually quite densely populated? Well, the outhouses and cesspools, when it rains, they bubble up and you have raw sewage in the yards, and kids start to play in the yards and they ingest fecal matter. So there's a transmission of waterborne diseases associated with this transmission. The other thing that is pretty well documented is that communities that don't have wastewater also have a low water consumption rate because they lacked wastewater. And so their domestic hygiene is also an issue, where they're not showering as much, where they're not washing their hands as much, or washing their fruit, their produce, because of the fact that they may have water because they have a local well, but they don't really have anywhere to dump it. So those are the issues that come along with not having wastewater. So colonias are located actually throughout the entire state. About 400,000 people are living in 2,300 colonias, but the higher concentrations are along the border. And so why did colonias happen? Well, in counties in Texas do not have the authority for land use planning, and prior to 1989, were unable to require subdivision rules that would avoid land developers subdividing land and selling lots without services. So you had a lot of unscrupulous landowners that were selling lots, but they were also a source of affordable housing. People would buy these lots and literally build them up brick by brick, and eventually build a home. They would start with a trailer home and then improve upon that trailer home. Since these were also residential areas, the counties where they did have authority was on septic system permitting, but they were not enforcing it. And cities that had colonias in their ETJs were also not enforcing the land use planning. So this absence of enforcement was compounded by a lack of political clout. Since they were geographically remote and isolated from the state and of a lower economic status, that led to this proliferation of colonias up until the early 90s. So what happened next? Well, because of the lack of infrastructure, this led to unsanitary conditions, which in the 1980s received the attention of the NGO, the media, and published this health threat that more than 300,000 people in Texas did not have wastewater. And so what you have here is some statistics back from 1991, and here you have Texas statistics on the rate of waterborne diseases per 100,000. And here you have border counties and their rate. And as you can see, you know, the hepatitis A is about twice what the state average was. The salmonellosis and shigellosis were about 50% over what the state was. And the tuberculosis was also twice the state average. So all of this public media led to two policies that were formed like in 1981. And this was Senate Joint Resolution 5, where voters approved the creation and funding of what Texas Water Development Board manages called the Economically Distressed Areas Program. And through voter approval, grants were $250 million worth of grants of authorization to issue bonds was given to Texas Water Development Board in 1989. But the other thing that was really important was that in order to avoid further proliferation of the colonias, model subdivision rules were required to be adopted by a county to avoid further colonias. And what the model subdivision rules did was that they required landowners that were less than 5 acres, if they subdivide, to put in services. Then in 2007, an additional $250 million was authorized for bond issuance by Texas Water Development Board. In parallel, Texas Water Development Board received $300 million from EPA for these colonias. And then most recently in 2019, an additional $250 million was authorized by the voters. So you have this money from Texas Water Development Board. Also, a GAO report the government accounting office of the federal government documented that about $1 billion had been given to the colonias along the entire U.S.-Mexico border, most of it which went to Texas for water and wastewater infrastructure. So what is the story? Why am I doing this? Well, like I said, you know, this is like you have all this money going out the door. And what I wanted to do is actually put a comprehensive report that of where the investment went across all of the agencies. There's lots of little pieces everywhere. There's limited analysis of data, and there's really, really a limited understanding on the reduction of the waterborne diseases, the spending across the agencies, or the lessons learned. And so the Secretary of State in their 2014 report issued that 90% of the colonial residents now had water and wastewater. And so they have this classification of red, yellow, and green. If you're red, you have no basic services. If you're yellow, you have water and wastewater. If you're green, you have water, wastewater, and landfill, and maybe some roads and drainage. So this leads to my research. I'm looking at 31 counties of information from the Office of Attorney General. And so I want to give a shout out to the OAG in particular, Dr. David Falk and his staff, Todd Gibson, who really do a great job of identifying these colonias. And actually, they provided me quite a bit of information. So I'm going to be showing off my new mapping skills. If anybody's ever interested in taking a GIS class, I also recommend Miguel Pavon's GIS class, because these are some of the maps that I learned to create. But there are over 320,000 colonia residents that live along these 31 counties near the border. And that's about 80% of the colonia residents within the state. Based on the 2010 census, though, if you look at the colonias within the state of Texas, they constitute 1.2% of the population. But for these particular 31 counties, they actually constitute 10.5% of the population. And as you can see on this map, most of the counties are pretty rural. They have less than 5,000 residents living in colonias, as you can see here in the beige. And really, the largest concentrations are in eight counties, starting with Hidalgo, then followed by El Paso, then Cameron. Then we also have San Patricio, Zapata, Webb, and Maverick are the next group of them. But otherwise, most of them are less than 5,000 residents. So this region is mostly of Hispanic origin. You know, some of the counties are up to like 97% Hispanic. They're some of the poorest counties in the state of Texas. And as you can see in this figure, most of the counties, 27 of the 31 counties are below 21% of the median household income for the state of Texas. So grant programs are really, really important, because debt funding basic services for people that could not afford an extra bill is impossible. And so when you provide grants for construction and limit their new bill to only being the operation and maintenance costs, it really makes the projects a lot more viable. And you can see here, some of these counties are really 40 and 50% below the state average. Overall, the state average household income is 51,000, and in this region it's 29,000. The overall state percentage of people living below poverty rate is 17%, and in these counties it's 42%. And so this is the whole county, so the likelihood is that the colonias are even further below those medium household incomes. So I'm currently working on two papers, and the first paper will focus on the programmatic, what I call the programmatic overview of the federal and state programs in the 31 counties. And specifically, these are the questions that I'm asking: is were the allocations of funds across 31 counties based on need? Where does there continue to be need? Did the infrastructure promote growth? And what were the lessons learned from the implementation of the program? So question one and two are related to where did the funding go based on need and where does their need continue? So the first thing I needed to do is to define what need was. And in this case, I use need as being what in my industry we call wastewater coverage or the percent of population with wastewater service. And the reason I did not use water and I only used wastewater as the indicator was because when I looked at the literature, virtually no one had wastewater and 75% had water. So whenever funding went in for projects, the project included both water and wastewater where there was no water and only wastewater where there was water. There was no purpose in putting in wastewater service if there was no water service. So the indicator that I used is wastewater coverage. Wastewater coverage for each county's colonia's population is not available either as a county or individually at the colonia level. There's no publicly available report. It's not tracked by the state or any other regulating body. So I had to calculate it. So I'm going to go through this figure that shows how I got the data to answer my questions. So here in this data, so the colonia population, like I said, the Texas Attorney General does a wonderful job of having the 2000 and the 2010 population based on census block information. They really wrote a really cool algorithm where they were able to apportion data on these colonias. And they also have mapping with the shape files for each of the colonias. So using this information that I got from the Texas Attorney General, I was able to cluster the colonias by utility based on the mapping. I was able to get the what they call certificate of convenience and necessity from the Public Utility Commission, which tells me what the boundaries are of these utilities if they're not serving a city. And then the other data that I used that I needed was when wastewater went in and when were projects completed. So Texas Water Development Board actually has a colonia report, which I used that has when funding was approved, where projects went in, and who was the grant recipient. So based on FOIA, I got more information from them as far as what colonias they served. And from USDA, I also got when they approved funding, where, how much funding, who the grant recipient was. TDA and NADBANK provided me just a little bit more information with regards to when projects were completed. But these two agencies were the agencies that provided the least amount of funding. Actually, Texas Water Development Board provided 80% of the funding that went into the wastewater. So what I had to do as part of this effort is I needed to calculate when wastewater went in so I could calculate the percent of the population with wastewater and therefore consequently those without wastewater. So I did interviews with 92 utilities to verify the agency information, the year wastewater service was provided to each colonia and those colonias that still had no service. So that was really interesting because when you want to call somebody, I did a lot of cold calling and I had to like beg and tell funny stories so that some of them would actually want to take my call. So from this process, I was actually able to get wastewater coverage annually between 1995 and 2018 and how much funding was approved from 1995 to 2017. And I was actually able to actually also calculate the number of new connections that came in annually. And this is all estimated, of course. So I'm using this model because I wanted to dig a little deeper and really calculate if the amount of funding that went to each county was what was needed to go based on the needs. So if you have a greater need, in theory, you should get more money. So the data used for this is the funding dispersed for wastewater projects between 2015 and 2017. So I actually completed using the ArcGIS geoprocessing tools. I'm doing a geographically weighted regression using this model, where the dependent variable is the dollars that went for that county for wastewater. And the independent variable, or the treatment variable, is the need in 1995. And so I'm not quite ready to share my results. I should be finished with my paper within the next month or so, hopefully get it ready for publication. The next model that I used in the same paper was, I wanted to do a second regression. And here, the population without wastewater in 2018 is a function of the total investment and the 1995 need. So basically, I'm asking the question, did the investment in wastewater service achieve the same results based on need? The dependent variable here is the 2018 Colonia population without wastewater service. The independent variable here, which is the treatment, is the investment that went in, but I'm also controlling for the need in 1995. And the reason I added this second variable was recognizing that a smaller need could be dealt with much easier from a financial and technical perspective than a larger need, like in Hidalgo County, where they had almost 90,000 residents without wastewater service. Spread it would be very different than a community that only had a need of about 5,000 residents. So for question three, so like I said, I'm not sharing my results quite yet because they're still under review, but for question three of the same paper, did the colonias grow? And question four, what were the lessons learned? These are the data sources that I'm using. And so why did I ask question three, did the colonias grow? Who cares? Of course they're gonna grow. They got wastewater treatment now. That's important, right? Well, the literature on US-Mexico border coincides that there was a rapid growth going on the border, larger than the rest of the United States or Mexico, and that the passage of NAFTA in 1993 would further stimulate that growth. And this is relevant because a lot of design and financing decisions are being made based on the assumption of growth. So when you're a community, you're not going to build a wastewater treatment plant just for your community at the size of your community in that moment, because by the time you get it built, you could have grown and it would not be enough. So you usually projected a growth of over a 20-year period. And a lot of communities use between 1.5 and 2% annual growth. And what this results is in a sizing of a larger infrastructure that increases not only the capital investment, but you have bigger infrastructure, you have larger amount of funding that needs and larger amount of operation and maintenance costs. At the same time, when you're doing your pro formas, you're looking at a larger base of people that are gonna pay into this infrastructure, and that larger base will, you know, affect the rate. But what happens if the growth doesn't come and you have insufficient users? Well, there could be a lot of problems with that. You can have oversized wastewater infrastructure, and that comes along with operational challenges because you're not getting the flow. The lack of flow reduces your organic load. And so that's why I wanted to ask this question. And then the lessons learned was based on interviews. So let me go through this data that I used for the first question of did the population grow? So Office of Attorney General gave me the data for 2000 and 2010. So I was able to, based on census block information. And the data for the 2019, I obtained from the American Community Survey, but unfortunately that's only at the census block group. So these populations, the colonias don't fit very nicely within the census block information or the census block group information. So there was a process that was needed to apportion how many people are in that. And the Texas Attorney General did that for 2000 and 2010. And using some of, you know, using their basis of how they did that, we did the same thing, myself and Miguel, who's my co-author on this. We did the same thing using the American Community Survey census block group data, but we used the tool from ESRI, ArcGIS Geo Enrichment Method, which apportions apportions the amount of population. So that was the comparing between 2000, the changes between 2000 and 2010, and consequently 2010 and 2019 would help me answer that question. But I also did interviews with these 92 utilities, and I always ask that question, did you grow? And what were the lessons learned? And so interviews, I also did five interviews with the program managers to review these results. And again, some of these lessons learned. So that's the methodology that I'm using for my first paper. So what are the policy considerations with this? Well, the relevance for me is twofold. So I wanted to document the combined results amongst the various agencies, as well as the lessons learned, because even though in the United States, approximately 99% of the population has achieved sanitation, the lessons learned can serve as a model for other countries that are transitioning towards increasing water and sanitation infrastructure, because it is a United Nations goal under the SDG 6. And colonias can be like those of developing countries. So I really have a robust section in my paper on the lessons learned, what worked well and what didn't. Okay, so my second paper, using all of this data, focuses on the public policy of creating a program to build water and wastewater as to what was the purpose of it. And the purpose of that time to have this program was because the colonia's residents were having the risk of waterborne diseases. And so what I wanted to ask is, was there a significant reduction in the incidences of water-related diseases because of first-time sanitation? And what were some of the other co-benefits that were received? So I am a public policy wonk, and we do like to use theoretical frameworks as a way to organize our data. And one of the fundamental frameworks that we use in public policy is Anderson's 2000 public policy making model. I also used the World Bank's publication on impact evaluation in practice. And the National Research Council in 1996 also published a really great book on measuring and improving infrastructure performance. So this begins with the policy here, the policy of the 71st legislature where the EDAP was created. And then you have what, you know, a typical logic framework has inputs, outputs, outcomes, and impacts. So I actually wanted to look at impacts, and I'm looking at improved health because that was the objective of this, and the incidences of waterborne diseases. There's other, you know, the literature, I have these other indicators because there is literature that looks at some of these other indicators, and I found that interesting. Assess property value, educational attainment, they've done that in India and China, reduction in crime as well. So I'm actually using data from the previous two questions, but now I'm adding the reported waterborne diseases. I'm looking at both the county level and the zip code level as a dependent variable. And I'm basing this on a publication by Tara Watson in 2006, where she looked at the wastewater investments in U.S. Indian reservations between 1960 and 1999, for 38 county groups. And she used this linear regression with fixed effects. And here, you know, my waterborne disease is at the county level. My treatment is sanitation. And this is her model. I'm just gonna be applying it, but I'm controlling for some time varying characteristics of the county. And in this case, mostly I'm looking at MHI and population. Because bigger counties in theory should have more capacity. I'm also doing a time fixed effects and a county fixed effects. And then she also included this interaction term. So I'm using her model, and if anybody wants to ask me, I will try and explain it after I finish my presentation. So here's an example that I have here. So this is one, here's an example of where I apply this public policy and municipal infrastructure. You know, assessing the impact. I had done this in my previous job is we did a bunch of surveys in the county of El Paso because we had invested about $100 million worth of funding in this, and we wanted to see if that had been achieved. And so what we have here is that here are the incidences of waterborne diseases and of hepatitis A, and specifically in El Paso County. And this was the incidences for the average incidences for the state of Texas. And up here we have these projects that are going in. This is water, and these two are wastewater. And we're seeing that there's a reduction in wastewater. So, but we can't say that there's a causal effect because this is only one county. And the idea is to look at the 31 counties. So what are the policy considerations for this specific paper? Well, in spite of, you know, federal and investments going in infrastructure countrywide, you know, we still have a D+ in water and wastewater infrastructure, you know, according to ASCE. So funds are growing very limited. Program evaluation starts to be much more important. And so from a standard of measuring performance, you know, I want this paper to add to an emerging body of literature where you measure municipal infrastructure outcomes and impacts. I want to do an impact evaluation. It's not typical of most water and wastewater infrastructure developed in the US because everybody needs water and wastewater, but it's really important to go back and look at it so that it helps local governments prioritize funding. And then from a programmatic perspective, you know, understanding the degree of impact in the Texas colonias is really important. We have a lot of colonias that are green now. So what happens? And those that aren't, what are the barriers to service? And how can we engage policymakers in addressing these barriers to service? So as I mentioned, this first paper is about finished and will be sent to my committee for comment. The second one is about half written. And so I intend to finish this by June, but I want to end with one message. So this work is to promote the relationship and the intersection between public policy and municipal infrastructure. I don't know how many engineers there are out there, but I always tell people it's not about pouring the concrete. It's about the impact and the objective this is supposed to have. And I honestly don't want to be known as the colonial lady based on my work. I really would rather be known as that this is a good example of what can be achieved in a short time and how you can document results. So with that, I end my presentation.
Thank you so much, Maria-Elena. That was fabulous. A really nice overview of the issues. And I attended the TWIC meeting yesterday, and they mentioned that colonias were defined in 1990, and after that, it's from 1990. Is that correct, Maria-Elena?
Correct. Well, the ones that I used, I obtained from the Office of the Attorney General.
Right. And so your initial work focused on wastewater, which, as you indicated, was a much bigger challenge for the region. What would it take now to look at water access? And do you think how many people or, you know, colonies lack access to water?
So I think one of the big issues right now with water are those small isolated communities that still don't have water. And the reality is that you still have many colonias that are considered to have water because they have individual wells, but they may not be doing the right water quality testing and the right monitoring of water quality. So that could still be an issue. You also have these small mutual utility districts that have very little capacity that are also having these types of issues. And so one of the things that I write about, the lessons learned in it is the type of institutional capacity building that's really important. It's not as costly as building infrastructure, but there's a lot of human element that goes, and there's staffing issues associated with it. So that's one of the things that I feel that is important in engaging policymakers with these barriers of service that still exist that could potentially be removed by any, you know, programmatically.
Right. So I guess I would like to open it up to anybody in the audience who has questions, or if you want to type into the chat or unmute yourself and ask the question. please feel free to do so. And while we're waiting for some questions, maybe Maria-Elena, what is the future of the EDAP program with the Texas Water Development Board? Is that or the BEC program or many of these different programs?
Right. So I, you know, in 2019, the voters of Texas approved an authorization for Texas Water Development Board to issue a fresh pot of money, $250 million. And one of the things that I write about in this paper is that after 2005, there was a significant decrease, or around 2005, there was a significant decrease in funding. Actually, the decrease in funding came before that, but there was a backlog of projects. And then once those projects got done, you start seeing after 2011 that new connections start to really decrease. My estimates based on all of the interviews is that there's still about 20% of the Colonia population without wastewater, even though the Secretary of State had 90% in the 31 counties that I looked at. Now the Secretary of State does not look at all of these 31 counties, but I still documented that there was about 20% need out there, and a lot of it was rural need. In these small communities, a lot of the big projects, the low-hanging fruit has already been done. And so right now, the ones that have the least amount of capacity are the ones that are going to be needing assistance. There was, you know, one of the things I was really surprised was hearing from these small water utilities on on-site septic systems. How open were they to that? Texas Department of Agriculture is really provides CDBG funding and USDA as well for on-site septic systems. But it's really important that should these on-site septic systems be implemented, that the counties have a really strong ability to enforce the maintenance of it, where they're inspecting every 2 years and they're providing technical assistance and tools for the communities on wastewater for that.
Great. So does anybody else have questions?
Yeah, I have a question, if I can ask, Bridget.
Go ahead, Michael.
Yeah, so here's a, so, you know, our consortium is really sort of focusing on both this connection to water and energy. And you can consider water or energy to be resources that could be made available at sort of the utility scale, or at the individual homeowner. We would look at that as being sort of baseload versus kind of intermittent. In other words, do you have an entire utility scale water distribution system, or is it more efficient or effective at the neighborhood or even at the home, at the house scale? And so as you're thinking about this through BEC and other programs, is there a way that you kind of conceptualize the best solution for communities that are that don't have consistent access to water or energy on the best type of solution for them? Like, what are the characteristics of those communities?
Right. So all of the utilities that I interviewed, not one of them talked about having an issue with regards to access to power. It doesn't mean that some of these residents do not, or that they can't get service to them because they're so isolated. But what one thing that did come up regularly, and this, I had that experience when I created a program for energy efficiency in Mexican communities, is that water utilities tend to be the largest energy consumer in a community. And at the same time, energy is either the number one or the number two expense that they have. So one of the policy considerations lessons learned that I'm including is that these utilities really need assistance in energy efficiency so that they could reduce their operation and maintenance costs and possibly have a better management of their system and possibly also give them more a revenue source for expanding service or improving service. But honestly, Michael, I did not find that they really lacked that energy in the home. But again, I didn't do a household survey and I only focused on the utilities that had service.
So there wasn't really a situation where if the cost for managing the water, treating and distributing the water started to increase, because as soon as things become really expensive, they're no longer really accessible, right? I mean, functionally.
Right.
And so was there a thought to use some sort of renewable energy systems as a way of supplementing utility right. scale to kind of make that bite a little bit less deep?
Right. So here's the interesting thing is that there was, and this is only one example. There was a utility, I believe it was in San Benito, that put in with funding, some grant funding, they put in some solar panels. And they I think it was subsidizing about 10% of their energy costs. And so one of the things that we learned through that process was that you can put in the solar panels, or you can put in these types of efforts to reduce energy consumption, but you can't walk away because the utilities are not expert in operating solar panels. And I'll give you another example. Our facility in Juarez, we put in a solar panel as well. Unfortunately the one that we picked, the company went bankrupt, and ultimately we had no technical assistance to help us and ensure that the system was working. So really, if we're looking at providing renewable energy, I think it's a great opportunity, but that follow-up and technical assistance needs to continue after it's implemented, because if not, their core business of providing water is wastewater, that's what they're going to focus on. And if something starts happening with the solar panels, they'll just switch over to conventional energy. Does that answer your question, Michael?
Oh, sorry, I was on mute. Yeah, it does. And thankfully, there's not a whole lot of moving parts with solar panels.
Right. But I'll give you an example, like San Benito, the big issue that they had with the solar panels is that they had rodents chewing on the cables.
Right. It's the little things.
Right. It's those little things that they don't have time to what's the right word? There's a saying, the word's not coming to mind, but where you're, you know, kind of like trying this or trying that, trying to figure out, you know, what the issue is. But that is one of the things that if a significant effort is made in providing renewable energy, there's got to be someone that they can call on the phone and say, hey, it's not working. Can you come and check it out for me?
Right.
So, thanks, Michael. Erin, are there any questions on the YouTube channel?
Yes, there are. We have one here. Research on Water and Energy Access asks, okay, here's a question. Many of the metrics listed, like MHI and population, are not collected very often. Are there other metrics that might be more robust, especially in the short term?
So I don't know what other metrics you would use for water and wastewater aside from coverage.
You provided the data annually, didn't you?
I have the wastewater coverage as it came on annually. But MHI, the reason I have MHI there is more to control for those that have more lower MHIs are gonna have more trouble implementing their project and will have issues with health if they have a lower MHI versus a county. Some of these counties are ranching counties and they don't have as low MHI, so which is reason why I did it. And it's interesting because the other one that I thought about, you know, most of these are pretty homogeneous communities. They have a lot of similarities in terms of being Hispanic, age groups. They tend to be older or younger because they tend to be more vulnerable populations. So I really had a hard time trying to look at other types of indicators to use in my model. Obviously, there's a whole lot of other indicators they can use for other quality of life aspects, like do they have grocery stores? Do they have, are they a food desert? Do they have healthcare nearby? I mean, those are obviously things that are important for these communities, but it's definitely not one that I can, it makes it difficult for me to control within my model.
So is that it, Erin? Any other questions? I guess not.
That was the only one.
Okay, thanks.
And I think
I think Melanie has a question. Go ahead, Melanie.
Hi, thank you. I'm Melanie Scruggs. I'm actually a member of the TCEQ Border Affairs team, and this was such an informative, awesome presentation. I was wondering if you were interested in looking at water quality data as one of the indicators to study the impacts, or if there were any issues with looking at water quality as opposed to the health outcomes.
Right. So definitely that's something that can be looked at, especially now that I have the wastewater coverage. One of the items that I had wanted to look at was even water quality along the river, some of the places where they were discharging, to see how that improved as wastewater was improving in coverage. Obviously water quality in terms of potable water quality is a little more, well, that could improve as well as you're increasing your wastewater infrastructure, because in theory you're building a more resilient and a utility with more capacity. That would be an interesting question to look at. If somebody gives me funding, I'll do it. At this point, I need to finish and get back on the job market, but definitely it's certainly doable.
And Melanie, we do a lot of work on water quality for TCEQ. So if there are some specific things that you're interested in, we'd be glad to chat with you also.
Hey, thank you. I know that they're very interested in looking at the point source pollution, especially in the Little Rio Grande, and the impacts of water infrastructure. And I was actually watching the unveiling yesterday of the proposed infrastructure bill by the president. So it looks like there's going to be a lot of need to study where water and wastewater infrastructure funding should go to meet needs.
Right. And so the big issue right now along these shared water bodies is not so much in wastewater, because a lot of the wastewater is now treated, but it's really related to non-point source pollution, such as stormwater, where you have cities in Mexico, cities have doubled in size in terms of population, but their extent has grown by 10 to 15 times. So you're having a lot more paved surfaces. There's a study that documents some of that. You have a lot more paved surfaces, and so you have stormwater that's running into these shared water bodies.
Well, great. Well, thank you so much, Maria-Elena, for such a fantastic presentation. And thanks to Erin and Chuck for providing technical support. And if anybody has any questions in the future, I see a couple of more questions going, hands going up. Ken, do you want to ask a question?
No, that was the applause symbol.
Oh, okay.
Thank you for a good talk. Appreciate it.
Well, I'm hoping I can actually get my results once I'm done and they've been vetted, you know, because the results have found some surprises. And so I shared those with the agencies, and they found them to be surprising as well. And so hopefully I'll have some good information to share fairly soon on the actual results of the analysis, because maybe then there'll be more questions.
Great. Well, thank you a lot, and we'll wait for your publications.
I just want to say I will be looking forward to that. With Bridget's help, I'm on the National Academies Board for the Gulf GRP. So the BP oil spill money,
program.
And they are particularly interested in what can be done to help the coastal area, Colonias.
Oh, okay.
Well, thanks, Maria-Elena, and thanks everybody for the joining, and I really appreciate your support. We'll connect again later. Thanks.
Thanks, Maria-Elena.
Thank you.